Good evening, True Life. We want to continue on with our series of studies on the sons of Jacob, the children of Israel, and how that their characteristics are found in the Israel of God today, the church, and that these characteristics are things that we must foster or try to control in our lives today. We're going to deal with another son today named Dan, from Genesis chapter 49, verses 16 through 18. Now, I don't have any way of putting the scriptures on the screen as I'm recording this in front of my computer here in my own home. And so if you need the scriptures, just grab a pen and a piece of paper and write them down, and later on you can read them for yourself. Genesis chapter 49, verses 16 through 18 says, "Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path that biteth the horse heels, so that his rider shall fall backward. I have waited for thy salvation, O Lord." Now, Dan was the fifth son born to Jacob. He was the first son from his concubine, Bilhah. Rachel, who was Jacob's most loved wife, was barren. She was not able to have children. And she blamed her husband. And so she said, "I'm going to give you my servant, and any child that you have through her is going to be my own." And so she gave Bilhah to Jacob. And she conceived and bore a son, and his name was Dan, for the name Dan means judge. In English, we recognize this as one who listens or looks at evidence and passes sentence. But I believe that Rachel probably had a different meaning for this, because she was trying to get ahead of her sister, and she felt like, okay, God has judged me worthy and has given me a son. But the word used here in the Hebrew had a different meaning, a wide range of meaning. The ancient Hebrew concept of judge is one who restores life. The goal of one who rules or judges is to bring a pleasant and righteous life to the people. This can also mean a deliverer, or one who restores life to his people. It had a connotation of being a deliverer, but also of one who ruled in cases. Now, one of the lesser meanings of this was to cause strife, and I feel like Rachel probably took this lesser meaning of the word as her reason to name him Dan. She was wanting to contend with her sister and to cause some strife. She was in a judging mood and was wanting to justify herself in front of her sister and her husband. There's so much in this word which should have been good, but unfortunately, in Dan was only fulfilled in a portion of it, the negative. Even though Dan could have been a deliverer and a just judge, evidently Rachel instilled into this son a judgmental attitude. Instead of being a restorer, he was a judge who passed sentence. When Jacob gave this course to his sons, he recognized Dan's characteristics and said that Dan would judge his people as one of the tribes. I believe that Jacob saw his potential. And I think that there's something here of significance that we might not have noticed. Dan was the first of the sons mentioned from Jacob's concubines. Now, it is only human nature to put down or denigrate those that we perceive to be less worthy in family or culture in the world today. But Jacob established the fact that although from a concubine, this tribe, the tribe of Dan, was on an equal standing with all of the legal-born sons. For you see, in God's spiritual Israel, there is no distinction made of bond or free. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 11 says, "Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, Barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all." In the church today, there is to be no prejudice or favoritism. Prejudice comes from a word which means to prejudge. We cannot do this in the body of Christ. In him we are all one. Jacob went on to say then, Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path, that biteth the horse heel so that his rider shall fall backward. And it's almost as if he took a deep breath and they said, I have waited for thy salvation, O Lord. Jacob, in recognizing this character trait in his son, probably realized that it had developed from his feelings of not quite fitting in with the sons of Leah. Dan may have even felt, as the first son of Bilhah, he should have been given special considerations, especially because the firstborn, Reuben, had seduced his mother, Bilhah, and subsequently had relinquished the birthright. He probably veiled it very well, but it seemed to rise up at crucial times and strike out at those who he looked at as being in control. Now, the adder mentioned here was the horned serpent. This was a snake which was the color of the sand and was camouflaged and would jump up and bite whatever came close to treading on it. Many times it would bury itself in the sand and except for the head, and would just wait for the opportunity to strike unsuspectingly. Now, this has sometimes become a characteristic of those who judge in God's place. Yes, there's a place for righteous judgment in God's plan. Had Dan been spiritual, he could have been used in his position to glorify the Lord and be a mighty deliverer. In fact, one of the most well-known judges who lived came from the tribe of Dan, and he could have been an even greater judge had he been spiritual. His name was Samson. Let's look at Samson for a moment. He was blessed. He was chosen by God. His birth was announced by an angel. He was given tremendous gifts from God, but he had a devious nature. By his serpent-like arts, he would lay traps for his foes and then with great delight watch them as they fell into them one after another. He could have led his people to many great victories, but he was not spiritual. He only thought of himself and what pleased him and how situations related to him. He set himself up as both judge and jury. He had some personal victories, but he was more concerned about how everything affected him than he was about how it affected God and God's people. Isn't that always the attitude of those who judge others? Samson did not worship God with all of his heart. He thought he could get away with doing things the way he thought best. He did not discern the true judgment of God. And this attitude was reflected later on in the entire tribe of Dan. They were not satisfied with the portion of land that they had been given. They were originally given land that was basically a part of modern-day Gaza. But they were constantly attacked by the Philistines of the area. And though some battles were won by their greatest judge, Samson, they were never completely delivered from them. And eventually, they were nearly overrun in their inheritance by the Philistines. And so they decided to go and find land that they could be safe in and be comfortable in. So they went to an area in the north, which was not in their promise, and ruthlessly slaughtered the inhabitants of a very calm and peaceful village and took it as their own. Then they went on a raid and to another tribe and stole one of their priests and took him and his idol to their tribe to be their own priests and set up their heathen altars so they would not have to interact with the rest of the tribe and establish their own form of worship. Now, it was patterned somewhat after the true form of worship, but it also incorporated heathen practices and idols. It seemed to be as if the tribe of Dan always felt the end justified the means. They then influenced the other tribes to follow their lead. Now, historians tell us there was always friction between Judah and Dan because Dan wanted to be first. I think it's only fitting that when Jeroboam set up the golden calf, he first set it up in Dan. This is what causes separation of the 10 northern tribes with the two southern tribes consisting of Judah and Benjamin. You see, when the tabernacle was to be moved, when the pillar of cloud or fire would raise up, the tribe of Judah was be the first one that was supposed to rise up and move. And the tribe of Dan was to be the last one. Praise should always be first, and judgment should always be last. But in thinking as judges, they always felt they should be the one to rule the nation. Subsequently, they caused a complete downfall of the northern kingdom. Jacob must have been speaking prophetically of this when he spoke of Dan as a serpent by the pathway who would bite the horse's heels and cause the rider to fall over backward. You see, eventually the position of judge was rolled into the kingship and was given to the tribe of Judah. No wonder Jacob said, "I have waited for your salvation, O God." It was almost as if he took a breath and said, "Oh God, I know that you have given Dan that he can be a deliverer, but he's a snake. And Lord, I wait for your salvation." Seemed to be a spontaneous vocal ejaculation by Jacob when he realized the things that would happen in Israel. In realizing their promise, a nation of Israel would always need a deliverer for their enemies. Aren't you thankful that today, through Jesus Christ, the righteous judge, the lion of the tribe of Judah, we can see the salvation of the Lord? Now, this word that Jacob used for salvation here is the first time it was used in the scripture. It is the Hebrew word Yeshua. I believe Jacob recognized that we would not be delivered by any judge, king, or priest, but only by the Yeshua, Jesus, or Savior of God, who would be all three rolled into one. Now, from a tribe who was only second in size to Judah, with 62,000 fighting men when they came out of Egypt, we don't hear a lot about Dan anymore, except for his ruthlessness and his idolatry, until the reference to this tribe in Amos 8, 11 through 14, when it talks about a famine of the word of God and curses those who rely on the God of Dan. What is even more shocking is that the entire tribe is left out in the book of Revelation when the 144,000 are sealed from the 12 tribes. It is as if the entire remembrance of the tribe is wiped from the mind of God. Now, many Bible scholars believe that the Antichrist, the man of sin, the 666, will be from the tribe of Dan. You see, to take the position of sole judge and arbiter of the people of God is to usurp the place God has reserved for himself. Yes, there is a place for judgment in the plan of God. In fact, he calls it eternal judgment. But the only one we are to judge today is to be ourselves, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 31 and 32. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. You see, he doesn't come to condemn us. He comes to chasten us. He comes to help us. He comes to deliver us. He comes alongside us to help us to become fruitful in the kingdom and not be condemned with the world. Jesus, in his teachings, was emphatic in rebuking those with a judging spirit. He said in Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 and 2, "Judge not, that ye be not judged. For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again." I do feel that although we are not allowed to judge, we can be fruit inspectors. For in the same chapter he warned against judging, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 16, "You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles?" We need to recognize things, but we do not need to judge them. We need to become deliverers and help them get rid of things in their lives that cause these situations and bring them into the kingdom of God. Don't hide away in the sand of your life waiting to strike out at those you feel who have the position or claim or recognition you think belongs to you. Judgment belongs to the Lord, according to 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 17. "For the time has come, that judgment must begin at the house of God, and if first begin in us, what shall be the end of those who obey not the gospel of God? We must recognize this as a part of our plan of salvation, according to 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 8. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them who love his appearing. He came as a deliverer, not as a sentencer. Jesus said, I have come that they might have life, and that more abundantly. He said, I did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through me might be saved. Why? He came to give us hope. He came to deliver us. James said in James chapter 4, verses 11 and 12, speak not evil of one another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother and judges his brother speaketh evil of the law and judges the law. But if thou judge the law, thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who art thou that judgest another? Paul told the Roman church in Romans chapter 1, chapter 2 and verse 1, therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself, for thou that judgest doest the same things. And in Romans chapter 4 and verse 14, he said, who art thou that judgest another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth. Yea, he shall be holden up, for God is able to make him to stand. You see, Jesus didn't come to be a judge, but he came to be a judge who says, this is what you need to do. This is how I can help you. This is how I can bring you through this situation. This is how I can help you to stand. In Romans 14:10, he said, but why dost thou judge thy brother? Why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. We must not be like the tribe of Dan and its leading citizen, Samson, and have a form of godliness, but deny the power of the true meaning of the judge to be a deliverer. When we begin to judge others, it is usually according to how they affect us. Yes, we can see what is wrong with others, but we should become deliverers, not judge and jury. We cannot put ourselves first, but must put God and others first through praise. Judgment must be the last thing on our minds. If there is judgment, it must be in the concept of deliverance. It is interesting to me to note that one of the symbols of the tribe of Dan became a serpent or snake. In his idol worship, he gave himself to that great serpent, Satan. It is a dragon or serpent fighting against the seal of God in the great battle in the book of Revelation. So maybe Dan is there after all. Lord, I don't want to be a Dan who is always judging others, but I want to be a deliverer who brings life, peace, and hope. Next week, we will study the seventh son of Jacob, Gad.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I've got Sing of the goodness of God.